world has come to see just how proud and beautiful you
What's going on, family? I'm Scrapbook Boxing. On behalf of Curtis Anderson, we will be continuing to examine 100 years of the greatest 150 black fighters in boxing history. You're looking at Bruce Flowers. He was born January 10th, 1905 in New Rochelle, New York. He stood 5'10" and weighed 132 to 140 and a half pounds. Now, Bruce Flowers would have 54 amateur fights with only 4 losses. He was not a devastating puncher. With just 20 knockouts over 100 professional fights, it was still very impressive because he fought his first year with 24 fights in 1927, losing only once. In his second year as a professional, he was just quite as impressive. And Bruce was elected to the Boxing Hall of Fame in Westchester County, 1967. He would defeat such men as Augie Pazzani, Jack Bernstein, Bobby Garcia, Billy Patrol, who was the Vargo Express, Spud Myers and Sid Barriston, Jimmy Goodrich, who was a former champion, and Ray Miller. Now, Ray Miller was a devastating puncher. He was a lightweight out of Chicago. Ray Miller would be the same fighter who would get it on with Ruby Goldstein. And ironically, both men would referee the Sugar Ray Robinson and Ruby Goldstein fight at the Polo Grounds that took place in 1951. Ray Miller had to replace Ruby Goldstein because it was 108 degrees in that ring. So much so that Ray Robinson was unable to continue after the 14th round as he was going for the light heavyweight championship belt when he faced Joey Maxim. Had he been able to continue, he would have been a 3 weight division champion. And he would have won the light heavyweight championship of the world. Bruce Flowers would also take on King Tut, Sammy Vogel, Alex Hart, and Tommy Grogan, all renowned fighters of his day. What a fighter was Bruce Flowers. He will be added to the list. 100 greatest black fighters of all times.
Hey.
Now, Curtis and I looked at my number four rated greatest fighter of all times. Henry Armstrong. He was born December 12, 1912 in Columbus, Mississippi. He died October 23, 1988, Los Angeles, California. His nickname was Homicide. They also called him Hurricane. He was in the Boxing Hall of Fame in 1954 and the International Boxing Hall of Fame in 1990. Henry Jackson stood 5'5.5". He had a 76-inch reach. Had a record of 152 fights. 22 losses. 101 knockouts. Phenomenal. Absolutely phenomenal. Those were his actual victories. His total bouts was 183. And you're looking at a man who won 152 fights. I just want to make this crystal clear. 22 losses. 101 knockouts. He had total bouts of 103 fights. Lost his first fight via third round knockout. Tried out for the 1932 Olympic Games. He learned many of his skills from Harry Wiley Sr., who taught him how to steer his head to the man's chest and place him in the direction that he wanted him to go. Taught him how to tuck his chin underneath his shoulder. Taught him how to use his left forearm to maneuver the man's right hand and hook off of that. From 1937, he would have 27 fights, 26 by knockout. Let's stop right there for one moment. 27 fights, no losses with 26 knockouts. And along the way, he would pick up the featherweight championship belt by defeating Petey Cerrone in New York's Madison Square Garden. He would be the first black featherweight champion of America to do so. The only man he didn't knock out that year, by the name was Aldi Spaldy. And he would go on and knock him out twice. In future fights. He was 59-1. Recorded 51 knockouts. Top names between 1938 and 1940. He would defeat Barney Ross. Madison Square Garden Bowl. In 1938. So he would become the featherweight champion by defeating Petey Cerrone. And then the welterweight champion by defeating Barney Ross. He would drop back down to the lightweight championship division, take on Lou Ambers, and defeat him after swallowing 5 pints of blood. Henry Armstrong's professional debut was July 27, 1931. And he'd be stopped by Al Lavino. Be stopped in the third round. Now he would take on Perfecto Lopez, March 28, 1933. He fought him 5 times. 1 win, 2 draws. He would take on Davy Abad at the Olympic Auditorium, June 14, 1934. Baby Arizmendi, November 4, 1934. He would also take on Tony Chavez and Richie Fontaine, Perfecto Lopez, Anton Black. He would face Benny Bass, who was a former junior lightweight champion. Fought out of Philadelphia. He was known as the Fish. be in the ring with Seferino Garcia, Midget Wargas, Mike Bellois, and Petey Cerrone, as well as Pedro Martinez. It also faced Tippi Larkin, Ernie Roderick, Alberto Chalky Wright, Paul Jr., and Lou Feldman, Eddie Zibbitt, as well as Juan Zarita. Baby Arizmendi, Fritzy Zivic, Richie Fontaine. Phenomenal fighter was Henry Armstrong. Have him ranked number 4. Greatest fighter of all times. Henry Armstrong would have 5 title defenses in 1939 in the month of October, 1 month alone. And have 19 welterweight title defenses. Within 10 months, he would accomplish the featherweight, the welterweight, and the lightweight championship. King. When you mention Henry Armstrong, you are mentioning success of all levels. Henry Armstrong is not to be compared with any fighter who wins 4 titles simultaneously. It's not a comparison. He would knock all them guys out. Because Henry Armstrong fought at a time when you had to go 15 rounds. The rules were completely different. They would take rounds away from you, not points. So if you drop the man with points, he can always get up and knock you down 2 or 3 more times and earn those points back and more. When you take away rounds, you took away a complete round. Fight fans today need to understand boxing. It is not the same. When Henry Armstrong defeated Lou Ambers, he defeated the lightweight king. There wasn't other fighters in the lightweight division who had a title. Because he cleaned all those guys up in the ranking system. So whoever the silver champion was, whoever had this title, that title, they were in the top 10 and Henry Armstrong wiped them all out. So he cleaned up all the titles, if you want to call it that. Let me move on. Henry Armstrong, one of a kind. You would never have a Henry Armstrong again. It's over with. Let's appreciate the man for who he was, the accomplishments that he would create. For all the top men in his division of his time. Yes, he was in there with Ray Robinson and Bo Jack, both in 1943, both in New York's Madison Square Garden. You see, Henry Armstrong, I lost to Fritzy Zivic, 1940. October 4th, to be exact. On that undercard, you had Ray Robinson. And he would take on Ray Escaviglia. They would call him Joe Escaviglia, but his name was actually Ray Escaviglia. He was a taxi cab driver in the Bronx, New York. And when Ray saw that his idol had lost to Fritzy Zivic, he said, "I want a piece of that." A year later, he would take on Fritzy Zivic and he would defeat Fritzy Zivic. He was in the second row when he saw Fritzy Zivic stop Henry Armstrong in the 12th round. Once again, New York's Madison Square Garden. And that's where he wanted to face Fritzy Zivic. And he would take out Fritzy Zivic by going the distance once again. Henry Armstrong fought them all. One of the top welterweights in all of boxing. And you know what's so interesting? He would be the 3rd, actually the 4th, black welterweight champion in boxing history. You had the Barbados Demon, Joe Walcott. Then you would have Dixie Kidd. Then you would have Young Jack Thompson. Then Henry Armstrong. You would have Ray Robinson. Oh, what names you would have. some of the greatest fighters of all times. Let's take a quick look at Jimmy Bivens' career for one moment. His name was James Lewis Bivens. Born December 6, 1919, Dry Branch, Georgia. He died March 7, 2012. He was 92 years of age at the time of his death. And he was residing in Cleveland, Ohio. I met Henry Armstrong. I met Jimmy Bivens. Many, many more. And he would defeat 8 of 11 world champions. Fought from 1940 to 1950. Stood 5'9" and had a 76-inch reach. He had a total bout career of 112 fights. 86 wins, 31 knockouts, 25 losses, 1 draw, and he was stopped 5 times. Now, Jimmy Bivens was one of 5 fighters who would have an outstanding amateur career. He returned professional January 15, 1940. The same year as Ray Robinson, Ezzie Charles, I would say Jake LaMotta, because Jake LaMotta got his professional license in 1940. He just didn't have his first fight until 41. Willie Pep, Cleo Shane, all them guys began their careers in 1940, as well as Ike Williams. But Jimmy Bivens would face Moses Brown, who was 7-0, fought him at the Hickory Park in Melville, defeated him July 1st, 1940. Would take on Charlie Burley, 31-4-1, at the Hickory Park in Melville. Would defeat him September 3rd, 1940. He would take on Anton Christofortis, March 5th, 1941. He had a record of 39-9-7 at the Public Hall Arena. 1 win, 1 loss with Anton Christofortis. Teddy Zuoz, who was a middleweight champion. He had a record of 105-14-3. Fought him at the Cleveland Arena, and he would defeat him. Defeat Buddy Knox, Curtis the Hackman Shepherd, Lem Franklin, Milo Bettina. Now, Bettina was a portion of the light heavyweight championship. He would take on Billy Kahn, somewhat of a vacant crown. Be in a ring with Billy Seuss. Billy Seuss was a middleweight champion. Gus Lesnovich was also a light heavyweight champion. Bob Pastor from the Bronx, New York, was in a ring with Joe Louis. New York Yankee Stadium, or actually Madison Square Garden. Joey Maximin, Tammy Mariello, Archie Moore, Harold Johnson, Clarence Henry, Joe Louis, Booker Beckworth, Lee Q. Murray. I have to remind you, I'm stating this entire series at the top of my head, so if I stumble, please forgive me. But embrace these fighters. On behalf of my brother Curtis Anderson and myself, Scrapbook Boxing, I want to thank you for continuing to watch us list 150 greatest black fighters of all times in a 100-year span. Museum of the Forgotten Fistikuff series states that all great fights and all great fighters will never be forgotten on my channel. Salute to all the great fighters in boxing history. Salute to my subscribers. Look out for the next video. 100 years of the greatest 150 black fighters of all times. Thanks for your time. Oh, I cannot forget to mention that Jimmy Bivens was the Canadian Hall of Fame in 1988, the World Boxing Hall of Fame in 1994, the Greater Cleveland Hall of Fame in 1978. He was the California State Hall of Fame, 2015. Make sure I'm not forgetting anything. In the International Hall of Fame in 1999. Credit goes to Jimmy Bivens. Peace.